Filipko, I'm Cambridge ELT consultant, and today we are discussing reading and literacy in a primary classroom. This is not the new topic, and so we will be revising a few things that we already know and looking at some new things as well. So before we start, I will just tell you a few things about the company, because Cambridge University Press and Assessment works in Ukraine as a part of the Linguist Company, and Linguist Company combines the distribution, the official distributor for a lot of international publishing houses. Linguist has its own publishing house, and also as a part of the team, we have the Formula, a company that deals with math, science, and ICT. The Linguist company has been around for 18 years now. The 18th year is right now, so actually it's 17 years. And we spread a lot of materials, you can see here, and we work with the study materials all over Ukraine. And we have our new partnership program. This is a special loyalty program that you can learn more about. If you are interested, you can text me about it. And there is a new program. You can become a partner of a Linguist Company. We supplied, as you can see, 950,000 students with books, with new Ukrainian school books, and with other textbooks and course books for studying English and other languages. We have specific discounts if you work with the manager of the Linguist Company. You can learn more about those. And we provide a lot of methodological support for our teachers. You can see that it's over 250 webinars per year from different publishers and different subjects. It's not only English, it's also German, it's also maths, science, and so on. And you can see what you can study with the Linguist Company. These are English, German, French, Spanish, Italian, Polish languages, and also ICT, maths, and science. And all together, we are the Linguist Company, which is also the official distributor of Cambridge University Press. That's why we are talking about it. Again, before we start, you will, of course, be interested in your certificates, and you will receive your certificates in 5 working days, because we need time to generate those. They will be created throughout the weekend, and on Monday, Tuesday, they will be put together. And so you will receive a thank you letter, where there you will find a questionnaire, and after you fill out this feedback form, you will receive the link to your certificate. So please wait a little bit, and everything will be there. And finally, what do we do today? We will discuss why we read, how does it work, and there will be a few activities to take away. We will talk about reading as a whole, generally. You will have a look at how it works, and then we will work specifically on the young learners. So, why do we read? This would be my first question, just to activate your minds from talking where you're from to the topic of our webinar. Why do we read? That's something you type in the chat. Okay, thank you. To understand the world, I like this one. Most of you are talking about information, and it makes sense because in this era of information, we read to get information. But still, there are a lot of people anti-stress. That's a cool one. Depends on what exactly you are reading. But yeah. If you are reading to get more information about the world, you might get really stressed. But if we think about it, why we read, of course, there are different types of reading, and depending on how we read and on depending on why we read, we understand how we read, and. We might be reading to get information, and this is something that we do every day, but we can read for entertainment, for self-development, and so on. And then we have a very different type of reading. And so there are different types of reading skills, and that's the thing we will be discussing today, that reading as a skill is not reading an amount of words in a minute or reading with a good pronunciation. Those are not reading skills at all. Something we've been training as pupils when we were younger. I remember we had to read in a minute, you have to read 70 words or something like that in a primary school. But now we know that this is not a skill. This is a measurement, not more. And we cannot really assess those. So, look at this one. Okay, was there anyone who was not hunting for letter A? No, of course, because you've got the task. Do you think it's possible to read the paragraph with no letter A? And that's the thing you will be hunting for in this text. This is a kind of pre-reading task that engages students at the very beginning and that gives your students an aim to read. And this is the first aim, and this is reading for gist. And this is something we do when we look through timetables or when we are in a train station and we need to find some specific information. And we will not be reading everything word by word, but we will be searching for the train number specifically, ignoring the rest of the information. And we actually ignored most of the information in the text, trying to find letter A, and got tricked, of course, because there is none. Reading task is something very important for the engagement. Coming back to how do we use reading skills in our real life? For textbooks and articles, for studying, different reports, manuals, memos, emails for the job. Makes sense. And this is reading for information. Tourist brochures and guides. Again, reading for information. Websites and work and pleasure. And then again, if it's about pleasure, and here we can talk about novels, about poetry, this would be a very different type of reading. Now, what is reading? And here we will have a little bit of revision for those who were visiting previous webinars and maybe new information for those who haven't. So, what is reading by Penny Ehr? This is my favorite part in reading, and I'm trying to bring this message, to carry this message of her definition of reading. So, first of all, this is reading about decoding. If we can decode, as Sherlock Holmes was decoding the dancing man, if we can decode, of course, we can read. But is reading decoding? Do we need to decode individual words to individual letters to read the words? Of course, at the very beginning, or if we don't know the language and we are like in encrypt, deciphering the word by the letters at the very beginning, it makes sense. But if we look at this, can we decipher this? Those who know, do not type in the chat. Those who don't, can you see what's here? What is written here? It looks like signature. could be, but this is a thing that was taken out of the context, and let's have a look at the context and try to read now. Can you understand what is written here? Now. Yeah, but the one that is circled, this part that I showed you. Okay, Olha Malushonok, thank you. Her with. This is if we spend more time on this, you will decode it anyway. So she's a natural teacher, and it was a pleasure to have her with us. This is the part that I showed you that is completely impossible to decode without the context. And so decoding is important, but it is all about the context. When we read, the skill would be understanding, comprehension, right? Understanding what's the point of a message, but not to decode every single word, every single letter in the word. This is something we don't need as a reading skill, but we need this to learn how to read in the process of the beginning of learning the language. And so it is important to keep the balance between the context and this decoding thing. Now, when we think of the words in the text, we need to read all the words accurately in order to understand the meaning of a text. Is it true or false? Okay, we have true and false. Excuse me. We mostly have false. And you're right here, just to show you how it works. Okay, so this is the text that can show you one of the activities for your kids, like to and you know the unjumble the word, unjumble the whole text, but to read this text, first of all, of course, you need to know the rules and you need to know how the word is really spelled to decode this thing. But yeah, we cannot read something if we read letter by letter. As again, we were taught as children at school, but then the mind works this way that we read even sometimes the whole phrase as a whole. We think with those phrases, we think with the language, and the language shapes our thinking, and so our thinking then finds these shape in the text that we see, and this is how our brain works, that we need just the beginning and the ending of the letter, and all the letters should be correct, but they can be incomplete mess, as the text says. Now, if we understand all the words in the text, will we understand the text? We have yes, no, not always. Okay, let's have a look at this. I don't know whether there are any programmers here among the teachers. We can have different hobbies or second jobs, but to tell you the truth, I read this, I understand every word, I understand even chunks of the language, but I have no idea what it means and how it can be helpful for me. To understand the text, we always need to have some background knowledge. We need to, if we are talking about young learners, as well as with the text before, young learners would be able to read this text only if they know exactly each word in the text. This could be a small sentence or just one word that they need to unjumble. But in this case, if the student doesn't have any background knowledge on the topic, then it would be impossible to read and understand. And so that's very demotivating. You can understand each word, but they don't come together because you don't know what is programming. It's not your thing. That's why we start with young learners. We start with something they know right here and right now with their immediate experiences. This is classroom objects. I know that these are scissors. These are scissors. I can touch them, so I can name them. I know that this is my hair, it's brown. This is my t-shirt, it's orange. I know that this is my body. So immediate experience is something that we always start from when teaching the language, especially with the young learners. Then later we get to the family, to the furniture, to the things that students already know. If there is something in the text that students don't know, of course, we need to pre-teach, we need to engage, so they get this background knowledge from us and then can get ready to the text. Okay, moving on. This is reading as well as listening. It's top-down and bottom-up process. Read something, we need to decode, but at the same time, to read something, we need to have background knowledge. This decoding and background knowledge, somewhere in between, they meet, and that's where the reading is happening, in the moment of both information from our long-term memory and information that we receive immediately. For example, we read, the sky is orange. We have our background knowledge, so we can tell that this is wrong. But at the same time, we decode the word orange and we have in our mind that there should be blue. This is the phrase that we've heard a lot of times, and that's the true phrase. So our comprehension of what we are reading is happening in this bottom-up process. Oops, sorry. Now, the more words there are, the longer the text will take to read. Is that true? Okay. Getting some messages here. Sometimes complicated words. Not always. Okay, let's have a now brace yourselves. Let's read this part. And how quickly did you read the first bit of the text and the second? It took me, for example, 3 times more time to read the first part. And this is something very tricky. This is something we think that is better for our students to read short words that are not connected. But this is not true. Very important for words to be connected so you can train your reading skill of connecting, because just reading the words, this is the pronunciation skill. This is not the reading skill. And we need to understand this very specific difference. To pronounce is not to read. To pronounce by looking at the word is not to read. And all these training worksheets with rat, hat, clap, and so on, with these words, with one vowel or another vowel, this is not about reading. This is about pronunciation. And reading is being able to connect and to make sense of what we've read. This is only possible through the context. And if I ask you to repeat the sentence, which sentence would be easier for, which part of the text would be easier for you to read? The first one or the second one to memorize? Of course, the second one, because it makes sense. It has connections. And so when we study pronunciation, it's better to study through reading. That's why we have a lot of phonics sections in Cambridge courses, something like a fat rat in a black bag. That makes sense. You can picture it. You can it, there would be a picture of a fat rat in a black bag. There would be a rat sitting in a bag, and it's funny, it's emotional, you can play with it, and it is connecting, connected. Okay. If you have any questions or comments, I will be answering those and referring to those after the webinar. So please remember your question and we will get back to it. So we do not stop right now. All right. So we usually need to read and decode letters in order to read the words, particularly at the early stages of reading. But again, decoding is not reading. We do not need to necessarily read every word accurately to understand the text, but we have to know how this word is spelled accurately, anyways. When reading a text, we use our own world knowledge in order to access the meaning. And so we need to have this, we need to provide this knowledge for the students. The more clearly the words are linked together to make coherent sense units, and the more clearly sentences are linked to make coherent paragraph, the easier the text will be to read. And what we have to teach is these connections between the words and how they make sense together. And when we talk about but about young learners, there would be this phonemic awareness. We need to first teach how the word sounds and then what it looks like. And this is a typical rule. Listen before you say, say before you read, read before you write. And this is how all the tasks are built. First, we get some input through how we listen, and this is a natural order of things. Even if we talk about this natural approach with the language, first natural approach meaning that how we learn our first language. First, children, toddlers, yeah, listen to their parents saying the words, then they repeat those words, sometimes without making sense. Then they make sense of it, and finally they can see how the word, what the word looks like, read the word, and then reproduce the word. And I have here this phonemic awareness, like we have hieroglyphs in Chinese language, and we can have some activities for kids that can be connected to how the word looks, what the word looks like, and how we pronounce it, and how to combine the meaning in the word. And there is this activity I used to do with the children when we were working on the furniture. They had to build a house with the words. So they write down roof, 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 a lot of roofs for the roof, and then they have inside they have sofa, 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 table, 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 and they shape these objects with the written words. This is how you make them drill the spelling of the word, but at the same time connect it to the meaning. When we talk about young learners, we might have this question: should I teach my young learners orally for a while, or shall I teach reading and speaking at the same time? How should I use phonic method? Should my students know the names of the letters? Because we know there is W, but it doesn't ever sound as W anywhere. And should I teach upper and lower case of the letters when we are talking about young learners? And Or we start reading writing, we use global reading methods, like starting from the alphabet. Okay, so here is the contradiction here. Another question, at what stage should I teach the conventional order or the alphabet? So when we when we talk about the beginning of reading, we suggest, we recommend this, to begin reading only after acquiring some basic knowledge of the spoken language. So reading should not come at once in the first grade, at the first in the first term, and this is how we build our course materials, that the first weeks of studying would be only oral acquisition of the language, some basic spoken language that students can really acquire and own this language, and then we get to reading, not altogether. Then learning new alphabet should begin with learning single letters, starting with the most common and useful ones, and this is called phonic method. Again, this is the method that we use for our course book. We work on the most widespread words that students need for basic communication, and from there they learn more and more letters, but not in the alphabetic order, because there will be much more words containing letter O than words containing letter Q, for example. And so Q would be learned later than O. And names of the letters are not useful for reading at all. And with young learners, we first need to teach sounds and only then letters. And we teach lower and uppercase together when we come to letters. Sorry, a little bit of confusion here. Give me a second. Okay. Sorry for that. Coming back. Three. Okay, so lower and upper cases, we do that together. And when we talk about the alphabet, we will come back to this in a few other slides. When we talk about the alphabet, alphabet is working at the end of the when we work on the phonics, we start with this a o p b and so on, and when we finally learned all of those, even after we learned the sound ch and sh, then we get to the alphabet. This is the recommendation. It's that it doesn't mean that you all have to learn alphabet at the end of the first grade, but this is the recommendation for students not to get confused when they have this alphabet song, and then later we have problems with the pronunciation, because they hear that it sounds like this as a letter, it's named like this, but it sounds differently in the word. So first we make sure that students pronounce things properly, and then we get to the alphabet. A few things about reading as it is, how it works. So this is a typical reading lesson for every stage, but now this is not for young learners, but for every stage we have the same structure of reading lesson. So what do you think these mystery objects are? Some artifacts, yeah. Okay, I can see that you are looking at the picture, whatever you are writing, that's great. Works of art. Okay. Is the first one a work of art? Flowers, vase, plane. Thank you. Old book, vase, bird. Okay. Tree, vase, and plane. Does look like a bird and a plane. We will not spend too much time on predicting what these things are. But this is something that we do with the students, and we give them time to think about what it is, to predict what will be there in the text. Now we read about the objects and we try to understand whether we guessed correctly. So the first one is the Voynich manuscript. Okay, is there anyone who heard about this Voynich manuscript? I really recommend looking it through. It's a manuscript that describes unexisting things. The creatures that do not exist, the plants that do not exist, the whole world that doesn't exist, and it describes everything in, it's now said that this is unexisting language, that the guy created the language and the whole world and described it. But it's a wonderful artifact, as someone said, and it's really, really interesting to look through it. And we had a bar in Kyiv that had pages of this book drawn on the walls, and it's really interesting thing how to see how language works. No one deciphered it yet, by the way, because he created the alphabet as well. Yeah, it's an interesting fact. Okay, the second one. Right. This is Baghdad Battery. Have you heard anything about electricity 2000 years ago? Me neither. Before I was preparing for this webinar, I haven't heard about it at all. And this is really interesting. Okay, let's get to the last one. And the airplane. With this one, it would be interesting if you work with the students. It would be interesting for them to get to give some further reading and to decide whether it's possible or not. Which one of these could be a conspiracy theory? Because the last one sounds, for me, it sounds like a conspiracy theory. But again, you never know. And you don't have to only oh, you've seen it on Discovery Channel. It would be nice if you could send me the link because I didn't research much for this particular webinar, but I will definitely look closer at these things and maybe other things like that because this is something that is really interesting. This is new. This is unexpected. Yeah, we have our course book that teaches us to read and to use the words and grammar that we are now having in this particular unit and so on. But even with the young learners, you can bring them some information like this. You can make this text much easier and show them the pictures and somehow get them interested. And of course, they will have discussion in Ukrainian. This is normal because this is too much to discuss things like that in English. But still, this is about engaging students and teaching them this desire to read and to find out more about the world and what is true, what is false, to think critically. Now, the second task would be to really read the text, because the first one was to compare. We were thinking that this is a bird, but this is a model of a plane. We were thinking that this is a vase, but this is a battery. And the first one is a completely unexisting book, an existing book with unexisting language. Then the second would be always read for detail. And this can be a table, this can be a set of questions, match, and other things. But here we read for specific information. Place, when, size, age. So we have to come back to the text and fill out this table with more information that we see in this text. We don't have to reread word by word, but we need to find all the details. Now, then we talk together about what we saw in the text, what was correct, what was incorrect. Then we compare this table with each other and correct the mistakes if it's needed. So to sum up, we demonstrate something before we read to engage the learners. This is not reading for detail, for time, or for anything else. We engage, and so we give them this reading for gist, to find whether our guess was correct or not. And this reading for gist is very important reading skill number one. The second one, after engaging, reading for a gist, and then read for specific information, followed by the personal reaction. So we read to find the shape, the time when these objects were created, and so on. And then we discuss whether our guesses were correct or not when we first got engaged, and then when we got to the text. And so the effective reading lessons contain these phases: preparation for reading or before reading tasks, the reading itself, which can consist of two or three cycles through the text while reading tasks. This can be a table, then just one item of specific information, and then answering some specific questions. A follow-up phase, which often involves reacting to or working with the text in some way after reading tasks. And these sub-skills, reading for gist, reading for specific information, reading in detail. Here in the first one, it's when we read to get a general idea of the content of a text. Gist reading, sometimes known as skimming, is done at high speed. And we can set time limits for the students. Like, what do you think this is? Is it a plane? Is it a vase? Is it a bird? Find in the text, you have 1 minute. Yeah, so we give the time limit. We can ring the bell to tell them that it's over. You don't have to finish reading. Tell me whether your guess was right. And then we read for specific information. Here we give our students more time, and we read the text in order to find specific, to order, to find, to work with the predictions a bit closer. And this kind of reading, also known as scanning, again, happens in a high speed, but we might give a little bit more time for the task completion. And reading in detail. This is when we read the text in order to gather as much detail about it as we can. Detailed reading is, in contrast to skimming and scanning, is slow, careful process in which we often stop to think, go back and reread. And this would be for the task that involves thinking and personal reaction. We can only ask students to read in detail after we engaged them in the text completely, or in the story, or in the watching task, and so on. Ooh, we have so little time. So when we talk about reading for gist, we do it when we example tasks: choose the best title, match the headings and the paragraphs. And when we do it in real life, when we read emails, when we read news, when we read reviews, and so on. Reading for specific information, this is in the course, but this would be to find answers for the questions, to answer true or false. And this is when we read timetables, dictionaries, and so on. Reading in details, make notes on these topics to find differences between the two texts. And we use reading in detail in real life for contracts, when we sign some documents, for poetry, to find how we feel, for novels, for manuals, for recipes, when we follow them step by step, academic reports, textbooks, and so on. So when we study, or when we do something and read at the same time, or when we read for pleasure. Now, before learners read, we should pre-teach all the vocabulary in the text which they don't know. True or false? False. False. Why? because okay, those who wrote false, would be nice if you could explain to your colleagues why. Learners should always have a clear task in mind when reading. True. We should always give learners a time limit for reading tasks. The third one, not always. We always give learners time limit for the first reading task, for when they are reading for a gist or when they are reading for details. But when they are reading for pleasure, we do not give them any time limit. And these three. Let's get to 4, 5, 6. Doesn't have to be a gist task. You saw our first task was to think. Oh no, it was reading for a gist. But again, it doesn't always have to be reading for a gist right away. It can be reading for detail. The first one can be reading for detail. Learners should read text more than once with a different task each time. They can read the text only once. It depends, again, it depends on the task. What I showed you was a typical reading task, but they can be very different. And for example, if this is home reading, and they are reading a novel, they don't have to reread it. They can come back to some parts, but they don't have to read the novel first fast and then right away. When learners are writing answers to a reading task, they should use full sentences. No, again, here, they don't have to use full sentences because this is not the writing task. This is the reading task. So you see, when we read, and when we are focused on developing reading skills, we need to not to be perfectionist for writing, for answering the questions. We should be careful with the grammar, but only with the target grammar and with the target vocabulary. But with the rest, when we can be more flexible, because right now we are developing reading skills, and this is important. And yeah, coming back to the alphabet, with the young learners, we can work on the alphabet as at the end, as a present for the students that learned all the letters. We can learn the alphabet song. This is the suggestion, of course, and I know that a lot of teachers like reading, like learning alphabet at the very beginning, but really in real life, we don't even need alphabet these days to look into the dictionary because we have online dictionaries mostly. And this is the skill that students might need if they work in some specific profession where they need alphabetical orders. So we do not have to start with it, but of course we should know the alphabet later. Now, what else we can do with the young learners? We work with the sight reading, which is very similar to gist reading. We work with the flashcards. We work with the phonemic awareness all the time. And sorry, we have these sight words, like we see the whole world, the whole word, and we connect this word to the meaning. We can work with the print awareness and with the writing awareness at the same time. And this is before reading. Before students know how to read, they need to know how the word looks like. They don't need to know each single letter and how it sounds and how it names in this word. But when they see the word table, they need to find this concept in their head that, table looks like this word, chair looks like this word. And so we can have pictures and flashcards at the same time. So they get used to the shape of the word before reading. Because this is how we read in real life. We look at the shape of the word. They should be a part of the integrated process, this reading tasks. So we work with simple recognition, point to, run to the word, or this running dictation and other things, word trails, relating to pictures, the word to the picture, even before writing and before reading. We can play games, Pelmanism, ordering, recycling and revising should be there all the time. With the letter recognition, it might be important for students to, for some teachers and students to work on the writing and tracing letters. And so there are tasks like that in our course books with the basic patterns, and usually they're gamified. Word shapes is another fun task, so students can draw the letters even before writing. Phonics and spelling patterns. So phonics, this is something that teaches the regular patterns of the words, and there are up to 500 of high frequency words, and this is something that we should teach first. We develop from logographic to orthographic reading with the phonics method. Okay, I think we are running out of time right now, so I will just omit a few things. I will omit a few things and get right to the end. And I think that we will have another reading webinar to continue this fun. Start teaching letter sound associations from the first day before reading. Then separate sound from spelling. This is important because if we teach the alphabet and we teach A, B, C, D, students will find it difficult to pronounce sounds in the words to compared to how they sound as the names of the letters. Then recognize the sound environment. Watch out for native language interference in pronunciation. Provide opportunities for practice, like practice reading as much as you can, and practice pronunciation as much as you can with the young learners, but less presentation, more practice. Aim to decipher the code. At the beginning of reading, we decipher, and then we get to the reading skills. But remember that deciphering is not reading skill. This is the skill that we need to develop reading skills. And all this you can do with Supermind Second Edition. This is a wonderful course, illustrated and increased with the photography. We have older levels that aged up together with the students. There are no cartoon heroes there anymore, but real kids in the fifth and sixth levels. We have the full color activity book for Superminds now and new CLIL content that reflects first language studies like maths, biology, and so on. We have a lot of critical and creative thinking tasks in the Supermind second edition. For example, we work with creative thinking here. In this particular task, we work with the creative thinking for writing, but also for creativity as it is, like this one. Choose a spy gadget and draw a picture and write sentences about it. So you create something and you use the language as a discovery. Then here we work with the critical thinking, making charts and mind maps and other idea evaluating tasks. And also there is a wonderful digital platform for Supermind Second Edition that will teach you, that will help you teach and provide extra practice for your students. They can that they can easily work on individually. These are the components for Supermind Second Edition, students and activity book, and Super Practice book, which is the optional component. Students and activity book both have access to the Cambridge One online platform. Teachers components include teachers book with a wonderful digital pack that you can use easily without going to other websites and finding extra materials, posters, flashcards. And also there are possibilities to work completely online with Cambridge One digital packs with the content of Superminds. And we also have Superminds Ukrainian edition. You can learn more at Publishing Linguist UA. There are more materials like practice book, phonics book, reading portfolio, and so on. So visit Publishing Linguist UA to learn more. I will just remind you that you will not receive your certificates before 5 days after today. So you don't have to text me right away, but wait a little bit, and by Wednesday you will get your certificates. And contact me if you want to learn more or if you want to share that Discovery Channel video about the plane. I'm really interested. This is my email address. And if you want to order the Superminds, if you are interested, you can call these numbers. So please take your screenshots and I hope your world grows with these webinars. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, do not hesitate to text me. And there was a question with children with the special needs. I can't find the question. I'm sorry. If you could repeat it. Thank you. Thank you very much. In any case, if I was not talking about this topic today, we were discussing the reading and literacy in the young learners' environment. Yeah, but if you're interested in what we can do with children with specific needs, please text me. I will send you the brochure for dyslexic children. There is a wonderful guide that we have from Story Fun Edition, and I will be happy to share this one. Top-down and bottom-up processes. So there are two processes that are happening when we are listening and we are and when we are reading. So it means that when we are doing the receptive work, when we receive information, and at the same time, we let's look at listening, for example. When we listen, we hear the noise, we hear the sounds, the background sounds, and we hear the language. Someone is speaking. So we hear this sound. This is the process that is happening outside. But also we have the process that is happening inside of us. We are trying to understand that where this is happening. For example, we hear the noise of cutlery, tables, chairs, people are speaking all together, and we're like, aha, this is a restaurant. So the conversation most probably will be about ordering food. And then we listen more carefully and we hear someone speaking to someone like, aha, this is a waiter and this is a customer. So this is our background knowledge combined with what we receive from the outer world. And the processes that are happening are bottom up and top down. So bottom up is our understanding of the situation, and top down, this is what's coming from this situation for us to decipher. Hope it's understandable. I will happily send it, but please text me here. This is my email address. Sorry. Text me here and I will send you the link. All right. For further questions, you can call me. Here is my phone number. Please don't call me at night or at the weekend. I will not answer. But call me during the day and I will. This is my phone number. This is my email address. Thank you very much. Have a great weekend and see you at the next webinar in October.